Hello.
Okay. Sorry for the delay caused by PhD defense today at our institute. By the way, very related to the topic of today's talk. And we can start with the talk of Alexey Rudenko, devoted to intersection of projections of Markov process and Karnorov. Please.
Thank you. I will share my screen and then start. So now you should see my presentations.
Yes.
Okay. My talk is about self-intersections for a specific kind of processes. The problem is like this. So suppose we have a process that is a solution for example, a stochastic differential equation of this type, where I is infinitely differentiable, vector fields. I will assume more conditions of them later. More specific type of Li will be considered, but for now, suppose there are, they just see infinity, so there's some equation, maybe it has a solution. Then if it has a solution, what can we say about the following? So if we take function f from a solution, which potentially can make the dimension of corresponding value is smaller. What can we say about self-intersection of such process? So, if I'm making a picture, then maybe it should look something like this. So, if I have a process in three dimensions, and then I kind of project it to some in theory two-dimensional object and look at the two-dimensional process, and then I study self-intersection of corresponding two-dimensional process. Why this question is interesting in my opinion? Well, mostly because of the following examples. So first two examples are well known, so we know that three-dimensional Brownian motion does not have does have self-intersection, and four-dimensional does not have self-intersection. But it turns out that there is some interesting process which basically fits into the same framework that I showed you above. So if we take a process that took coordinates as W1, W2, and third coordinate, for example, like this, you can also take Levy area, for example, or some other. It is a Markov process that can, okay, it is. It can be made as a solution of equation on the previous slide if we take specific Li and start from zero. So this is a partial case, but it is also well-known process which was studied by Legal and his co-authors, and they proved that there are no self-intersections of such process. Despite the fact that it is three-dimensional, so the intuition from the first two cases is that four-dimensional process should have no self-intersection, but three-dimensional process should have self-intersection. But this example shows that is not correct. So this is the start of the this study. So in fact, there are processes in three dimensions that may have or may have not self-intersection of the type that I showed you earlier. And in fact, I can show you another process in three dimensions. This process is not of Markov type. It cannot be just a solution of such some equation. It is a projection of such. So what I did, I just crossed out W2. So I crossed out one of the processes that involved in this integral. Instead, I inserted some independent process as a third coordinate. So it turns out that this is again brings us back to situation where we have self-intersection. So in the situation of first example. So there is some problem. So it is a reasonable question to ask when we actually, in general case, how to determine whether we have self-intersection or we don't. So this is what I was studying for some time. So in so this in sense is a continuation of the talk that I was giving last time, for example, in your half a year on the same seminar. So now I will give you some definitions that I need for specific situations to formulate some results. What I'm actually studying is I'm studying not any processes, but processes such that this, I recall that L1, LK is actually was vector fields that that define our process as in with the equation. So this will be the same here, but now I will choose them specifically as follows. So right now I choose L1 LK such that they are correspond to the first layer of stratified of algebra of stratified Lie group. So what does this mean? It means that we have a Carnot group. Carnot group is basically a group NRD with polynomial addition. So addition is just a polynomial, and it also has specific property that this is automorphism. Basically, it means that there is specific type of homogeneity on this for this polynomials that involved of the, on the summation. And then Li will be what is called basis for Lie algebra of left invariant vector fields. It can be defined like this. It basically how can you define this? You just take derivatives by some coordinates at zero, and then you just use group action to move them into so if L1 will correspond to into point x0 will be just derivative by x1 as vector field, and then we use group action to move it to other points. So we obtain some vector in all points, so vector field. And this will be left invariant vector field. Such vector fields that I consider. They also will be polynomial, if group is polynomial, obviously, from this definition. In fact, I consider only polynomial vector fields, and in fact, they are very specific for specific groups, so they cannot be arbitrary polynomials at all. So they're very specific, and the corresponding equation is easily solved because it's triangular. So we have, like on the previous slide, we have some specific integrals which are which describe solution. But since the algebraic structure can be complicated, I do not use such description. So now I also need the following py is a degree of LQ. So this is important. So each LQ is I also define not first L1 LK, but the full basis. Yeah. So this is basis, which means that it's linearly independent vectors. So and for each of such vectors we have a correspondence of some value of natural positive integer such that it can be regarded as some homogeneous degree of this polynomial. I can also give you a reason for this, but I don't think I should stop too much. So we have such construction. And Q large is just sum of all the homogeneous degrees. So Q large is homogeneous degree of the of this group. What is important for me for the following, I need this to formulate something, is the following construction. So suppose we have a surface of x equals to some value u. And we look at how the system of vector fields, so there's some vector fields here, how it corresponds to the surface. In particular, I look at the selection of this vector fields size M. So the size exactly the co-dimension of the surface. And I take M of such vector fields and look if it's if they kind of linearly dependent with regard to the surface. So they if I just act this vector fields on F, it means that it just I take here gradient are involved. So it is just the fact that this system of vector fields they are together with tangent space in this point, they span the whole RD. So this is a similar. So this is the condition that I need. And then over all such selections, I take such selections that corresponding degrees are as minimal as possible. They has to be as minimal as possible. So I want to choose such vectors that go away from the surface, but with such minimal total degree as possible. And then the corresponding sum is, well, it can be called some kind of homogeneous co-degree or some co-dimension, but the fact is that it can depend on X. It can depend on the point at which it is calculated, obviously, because this vector fields depend. And so it is a little bit tricky. Let me continue. So now I can just for each point I can also choose this MF at each point, and I also choose the corresponding vector fields at each point. So this is I can do this locally in a good way always, but only if it doesn't change locally. So sometimes I can do it in a good way, but there can be some bad points in which I do not consider, and which in this specific point, some specific point, the selection should be different. Okay. Yeah, and well, lemma, just to okay, I might be needing it, but the idea here is that each vector that of this form LIF is in fact can be written because they're linearly independent and they belong to RM, so they can be written as linear combinations of such. And moreover, coefficients are zero if for vectors that are larger than that degree is larger than degree of this. This is simply because the selection was optimal. So because the selection was optimal, this additional condition is true. Because if it's not true, then the selection wasn't optimal. So this is why it can be done like this. Okay. Okay, and now I will try to formulate result, but I have to say that it is a little bit new, so I'm sorry if anything goes wrong. Let's just say that. Okay. So what I want to prove? I want to prove that M dimension is two, if co-dimension is two, then basically there are always self-intersections for corresponding processes. And I also need an additional condition here. What is this, the additional condition? The additional condition is that this is L square is this double action of, so this is a differential operator of second degree acting on F. So I need one of the following, whether it is not zero at point or it is zero in the neighborhood of point. So what I'm trying to avoid the situation when such, this is actually vector because F is vector. So this is vector in Rm. I'm trying to avoid the situation when actually vector field, yeah, depending on x, such vector field depending on x, it should not be singular at point x zero. So it should not be zero, and then around the point it kind of rotates in different directions. So this situation I'm trying to avoid. So this is why I need such condition. So either it sticks in some direction or it's strictly zero in the neighborhood of point. Okay. Um, let's try to explain how I want to prove this. First, I need some additional definitions. First, I need distances in Carnot group. So, to start from the beginning, the idea is to build a local time that corresponds to self-intersections. In order to build local time, I will use expectations. So I will need to estimate densities of the process, and the densities of the process estimated using distances, corresponding distances. So that's why I'm introducing distances. So there are two equivalent distances. First one, the difference is that here it only k, and this depends on t. Here is d, but do not depend on t. So this is a difference, and this is kind of exponential distance, the lower one, and this one is just usual Carnot-Cacciadori type of distance in the Carnot group. So there, it is known to be locally equivalent by the results of Nagelstein one. So if we take some points x zero, then for each x y and some neighborhood, the distance, these two distances will be equivalent both sides. There are constants such that they are equivalent in the neighborhood of some point. Okay. So now, if we have such distance in Carnot group, then it is known, there are known results by, for example, Varopoulos and also some others, that then the density can be estimated, actually two sides estimate, Gaussian type estimate, where the power of t is equal to this homogeneous dimension divided by two. And as instead of usual distance in Gaussian estimate, we have the distance from the previous slide. So this is basically Gaussian estimate of this Gaussian-like estimate, form. So when we integrate, then from zero to one, this estimate, then we obtain such estimate. This is what I need for and this part I'm going to skip because I was talking about it later. So what I need to do is to, okay, yes, I need more definitions. Okay, so I need two types of surfaces. First surface is of this type. So this is the levels. Sets where f is constant, and the second one is a little bit tricky. So I have if I have x and y, so I condition is f x minus f y is equal to u. So we have two points that are in two level sets of f, which are separated by exactly u. So the distance is exactly u. So this is a little bit tricky. So they can be in different level sets, but the distance between them are still u. So they can be also here, but the distance should be the same. No, not the distance, but the difference. And so I will consider a new u surface measure on the second, and mu will be surface measure on the first type of surface. And for me, it is important that actually it is I can write integral by nu using integral by mu. So how the why is it true? Because we can make a parametrization on this surface in such a way that this f, for example, f from y from y is one of the parameters. Yeah, so this is equals to some v, and this v is a parameter. So then fx will be u plus v, and v is a parameter, and for fixed v, we obtain the level sets. So in fact, this equality is just a kind of a change of variables type equality, which are written here. So there will be some Jacobian here, but generally I can write integral by nu as follows: is integral by each on this level set, on this level set, then integrate by all level sets that are separated by u, with difference u of levels. So this is how I can study integrals by this measure nu u. Next. And this is the most important part, of course, because, oh, I'm sorry, this is incorrect. This should be index, yes, not just beta. And this condition, I will not explain this, the proof, but just words about how is this done. Again, we construct local time, kind of approximations of self-intersection local time. And this condition is sufficient condition for existence of the limit of such approximations in L2. So I have to write some kind of mathematical expectations. Then I use the conditions on the density, inequality on densities, as I shown you before. That's why this row appears here, because from this estimates. And then I rewrite it again in such a form as written here. So this is will be sufficient condition for existence of some local times. And if the local times exist and then zero, then we have self-intersections. So this is the main idea of everything. And I will not prove this. Yeah. So from now on, I will try to work with this. In fact, with this, with whole this integral. Yes. Whole this integral is interesting. So how can I bound this integral is crucial to the following. In order to do that, I will need the following lemma. And here, it's better to draw in such. I will try to do this. So what I'm trying to do, I take point x zero, and for this point, I claim that I can take a ball, the center of this point, basically. Okay, but x is some neighborhood of x0, so zero is not needed. I can just take a new point x. Yeah, it will be the center of the ball, but it is also near x0 somehow. And we have a surface here. Okay, it is not a good picture. We'll have to redraw it, but let me just stick with it. So now what I'm interested in the structure of this ball with regarding to this what I drew here is some level sets of function f. So this level sets, they in fact also can be drawn like this. So this will be another level set. U1, this will be U2, this will be like three level sets I draw. So what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to describe this ball using intersections with level sets. So here, what this is exactly intersection with level set. Su x epsilon is just equal to the intersection of the ball with level set of fx equal to u. And then this is just union over all level sets, such level sets that intersect the ball. So this T is in fact just all values of U such that level set fxu intersects this ball. And this is simple, but what follows is a little bit tricky. So now I claim that I can also do it like this, so that I can in fact maybe make this a little bit larger if needed. And then I claim that for first the measure of this level sets is bounded by such quantity, And the second is that I can describe Tx epsilon as the ball with regards to some distance defined by a vector field corresponds to some set of vector fields in Rm. So in fact, this set Tx epsilon is some kind of ball with to some specific vector fields. I wrote this x to remind myself that it always depends on point x at which we draw the ball. The good picture now will be like this. So this will be level sets. Now level sets are just some line in R3. So and when we have the ball, so it can intersect this like this. And then the shape of this this will be two-dimensional, and it will be something like this. Yeah. So it will be only those points, only those U that intersect the ball. So this will be two-dimensional, some kind of ball in different distance in this example. So in this way, I describe exactly how ball intersect level sets.
But let me ask you, this will be exactly the same ball or maybe a lot?
Yes, this is a very good question. In fact, there is no space here, but I should have written the following, that this way x, they are in sense uniform. So what does it mean? So where ex is in fact equal to constant, some constant doesn't depend on x, multiplied by L. LKI F at some point if it is in point some V, then it will be in some point U from V. Yeah. Yes, so something like this. So in fact, this vector fields should be taken as this vector fields. Remember, I told you this was exactly the set, the linearly independent set that defined this kind of homogeneous codimension. Yeah. So now I take this and I use this as Vx, but I have to select the point here. This is why it's a little bit tricky. So I have to select point here, and when I do, then I can take this as Vx.
Mm-hmm.
So now basically what I have to check, first of all, I have to check this, but this is kind of, okay, I will skip this because it is kind of known that I can do this. If the point is, I told you that the point is MFX does not depend on X, which means that I can do this. I can, estimate intersection of ball with the surface in the following way. So it is known. So the trick here is to prove that this Tx epsilon can be defined like this with some Vx of the following type. Okay, and now let's try. Okay, this is not the whole proof, but the main idea. So the idea is the following. So if we have two points, y1 and y2, that are on the same level set, so they are on the level set f x equal u, and they also inside the ball. So they are, distance wise the epsilon does mean that they inside two epsilon ball, basically. So we have if x zero, if we are in a small neighborhood, this immediately means that we can connect y1 and y2 with maybe here I should not jump to conclusions. Okay, with some gamma will be a curve that starts in y, ends in y in y2, and then it goes along the surface. So what's important for me is that I can choose this as follows so that I can. Okay, so. Yeah, this is maybe not obvious. I'm sorry. Okay, let me just choose some without this condition. This condition is not obvious. So if we choose such curve, then we can what I'm trying to say is that if such curve exists, okay, if such curve exists, let me take it this way. Then along this curve, the difference of values of L chi y at corresponding points can be written as follows. What I'm trying to say, because it's a bit complicated thing. So I'm trying to say that if I move a little bit along the surface in the following way, then it kind of does not change this significantly. Does not change this LKI significantly. So that I can still use Vx to approximate the ball, even though the actual value of Vx will be slightly different from the values of LKAF that I need to use. I need to use LKF because every ball, so every point in the ball, maybe I should have started with this. Every point in the ball can be connected as a curve with the center. And then I can write down the corresponding equation action on F, and then I will obtain the corresponding equation of this type. So this is the main idea. But then I have to make sure that this equation does not differ too much from Vx. Okay, this is it's hard to explain. I'm sorry.
But it seems to me that this is the relationship only in one side, because you prove that for every point from initial set, you have such a way which realizes the distance. And after this, you draw this way as the solution to stochastic to differential equation of desired type. But what about another direction? If you have equality, you have to prove that if you take any such solution, then you will get finally point which belongs to initial ball Tx epsilon. Not ball, but set Tx epsilon.
So what I have here inclusion. So what I need to prove is that for each point in the ball with center x, radius epsilon, if I take each point.
Or you just need inclusion.
Yes, I need inclusion right now.
Okay.
If fx belongs to this Tx epsilon, so this is what I need to prove. Okay. Let me try again. I take point x, take this point, any point inside the ball, and I prove that fy belongs to this. In order to do this, I take this the curve that realizes the distance, and then I prove that corresponding Vx, there are corresponding curve with Vx that are very that basically close enough. In a sense that it diverges again in such a way that the distance between the endpoints is can be bounded by the same distance, for example. and this will be enough. So the idea is, yeah. In order to do this, okay, I might be lying somewhere, but okay. the idea to do this is the follows. So I claim that if I change along if change LKI, if I look how LKI F, so this the one that here I used to define VI, and this the same that will appear in this. So when I look at this curve, then the coefficients of this curve is LI from gamma T. There will be the coefficients. Then I can use it to, after I take function F, I can put function F inside. And then I can each LI write as linear combination of LKI. This is what I told you before. And then after this, I have a curve that goes along LKI F. And the only problem that inside, this is a different curve inside, yes. So this is the curve, there is some curve inside. So I have to prove that I can put instead of the curve, I can put this point that I chose. This is what I need to prove. And I think that I can do it as follows. So I can, if there is a curve gamma that corresponds, then along this curve gamma, the coefficients can be calculated. The coefficients are small enough to do this. So this is the condition. I'm not going to explain this. I just tell you that the coefficients should be small enough here. But yes, of course, I might be lying here because I did not prove that such gamma exists, in fact. Okay, I'm sorry. So, suppose that this is true, suppose that such gamma exists. Yeah, and so then it is true. So in this case, I can proceed as follows. If I have such estimate for the ball, then I can use it as to estimate this integral. So I recall that this is exactly the integral that I need to estimate, and then I use the formula for the second one. I use the formula to rewrite it as measure as integral by mu. As again, I integrate first on level sets. So this is level set V, this is level set V plus U. So I integrate along level sets, and then I integrate by dV. And in this way, I can do the following. I can use this lemma, and this means that I describe this this thing on the integral in terms of this S, U, and T. In fact, it will be as follows. So the mu will be integrated, or will be just integrating over S, because it integrates over X2 and this integrates over Y2. So this will be just corresponding measure of S of the slice. And then I have to integrate by dV2 by multiplied by this indicator. So this is this indicator shows that I have to integrate over such level sets that corresponding inequalities hold. Okay, and I obtain the following formula. This measure mu can be estimated, as I showed you before. So what is left is this. So I need to estimate Lebesgue measure of the intersection of this special balls T. So what happens is that I have some kind of two level sets, two points x1, y1, and I have two such T written in each. And then I kind of project them in RM, and I look at their intersection. And I also have to shift. Yeah, so I have to shift it here. And so they have a common center, in fact. then I have to look at their intersection, the back measure of their intersection. This is all I have to do. Yeah, so this is the main idea. And okay, if my my description of T was correct, then I can do this as follows. Yes, I can do the following. I can prove the following theorem. So you can see there is an additional logarithm. Unfortunately, I have no slide for this, so I'll have to explain it. Okay, so what happens is that if we have two such balls, they in dimension in if m equals 2, then there are only two directions. One direction is LK1F and the second direction is LK2F. This corresponds to some PK1 and this corresponds to some PK2. So in this direction we go the bound is epsilon p k1 and in the other direction bound is epsilon power pk2. So this ball is in fact kind of the same as we draw okay, so pk1 is less than pk2. Okay, if it's okay, let me just first say that if both equal to 1, then it is everything is trivial. So, and PK1 always have to equal to 1, because otherwise the construction, the situation is not possible simple. So PK1 is equal to 1 and PK2 is greater than 2. So in fact, we have the ball is as follows. We take point, we take exponential from this LK1 and up until epsilon, the size of epsilon. So this is direction epsilon exponential. And then we take kind of epsilon power PK2 minus 1 neighborhood of this. And this will be my ball right now. And so when I intersect two such balls, the main thing is the direction of this LK1. So if the direction of LK1 is significantly different, then the intersection will be epsilon 1 power PK2 minus 1 and epsilon 2 power PK2 minus 1. Divided by sinus of the of this angle. This of course is a little bit tricky because the balls can bend potentially. So this is why this condition. So this condition means that ball basically do not bend, or if they bend in basically same direction. So if they do not bend, then this is true. If the angle is greater than, okay, I have to angle greater than, just write the sinus is greater than maximum psi 1 pk2 minus 1, psi 2 pk2 minus 1. So it is, if it's greater than this, then I have this estimate. So what constantly doesn't matter. So this is what I claim, and this is how I obtain the following estimate. Why logarithm? Because of this division by sinus alpha. When we integrate, there will be logarithm. Because alpha is basically a parameter of integration, variable of integration here. Okay, so I apologize. This is, of course, a little bit it's a little bit new. So here I have to probably stop because I told you everything that I had, and maybe if there are some questions, I can try to explain some.
Okay, thank you very much. Maybe somebody have questions or comments, please. I have a few questions. The first one is following. When you discuss this ball Tx, not ball actually, Tx epsilon, it seems it seems that it is very close to the following situation that we have some Markovian structure in the image of the F. Because you investigate this, you found this new vector fields, at least locally, which gives us the new distance, and it occurs that in this for this new vector fields we have a new distance, and then we can by the more or less exponential map describe everything in the image of the function f. Does it mean that the image of under the map f of our initial process has more or less Markovian structure? Just we can correct it slightly, and or we can just propose very close to it Markov process.
No, because no? For example, there is no process such that. Okay, so the problem with construction of the process is as follows. So when we have just a set of vector fields and corresponding corresponding homogeneous degrees, not every combination of such degrees can produce can be actually realized. So for example, if I have only one degree one, for example, P1 is one and the rest is greater, then this is not possible because all the higher degrees should be obtained as commutators of the starting from the first degree. So if I cannot do this, if I cannot obtain the higher degrees as commutators, then there are no process behind this. So this may not have process behind this. So this distance might not correspond to a process. So this is.
Interesting. So one can say that the projection is more or less essentially non-Markovian. Yeah, in this case.
Yes, it can. It can be. It it just it's a ball that does not correspond to any process.
No, I just about the process f of x initial. Okay.
Well, it can. You can say that it corresponds to this process, but
it has not Markov. Yes. Okay. This is the first question. The next one is: can you show us again the first slide with these different Brownian motions?
Different Brownian motions.
Yes, when you consider Brownian motion, different dimension, and.
Oh, you mean the example?
Exactly. Yeah, this one. So when we have this the last line, can it be constructed as follows? That we have. Actually, one can consider it as a projection, as you mentioned, of a four-dimensional process which has no intersections. But can I ask you about following? Suppose we have good diffusion. The family of good diffusion, I mean with elliptic generators, but the ellipticity vanish depending on some parameter in such a way that in the limit we have, can we have such a family of vector fields which satisfy just Hermander condition? And in this way we can get process which has self-intersections, but before in our family we have no such self-intersections.
So you're asking about passing to the limit, and
exactly.
If it's just possible that in the limit the change is it changes that
existence of self-intersections. Yes. So actually, this is a question about the topology of those bad points which you want to avoid in your F, I think.
Okay, I don't know.
I think it is interesting to catch such such effects. It looks like bifurcation. You have a very good picture without self-intersections before the limit, and in the limit they occur. It is interesting.
It is okay. I just do not understand how can I pass to the limit here exactly. Okay, I understand, but how it will work? So you want basically take this process and add here something like W3
yes,
by epsilon.
Something like this, yeah.
And then epsilon tends to zero.
Mm-hmm.
Then this process have some intersection and the limit doesn't have, yeah. It is possible.
Yeah, but it is interesting how then in this case it is how fastly they disappears. What happened? Yeah.
Okay, but yeah, you have to be more specific because yes, maybe it's there can be some interesting questions related to it. So.
Yeah, because in my opinion, self-intersections and intersection local times are some geometric characteristic of these families of non-smooth trajectories. So it is usual questions for differential geometry when some dimension switched or something, then we have interesting effects. So it looks like in this non-smooth geometry we have to get something similar. So it can be interesting to see.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. Maybe some other questions? If there are no other questions, thank you again. And Georgi, maybe you know who will be next speaker and when we have next session.
The next session is scheduled in 2 weeks.
Mm-hmm. In two
and
weeks.
Speaker will be Katerina Glinina.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and in 2 weeks it will be it will be like 11, May 11, yeah.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Okay. So we have long holidays. So I congratulate everybody with these holidays. Thank you. Bye.